search the world, but he couldn't fill me. Man's empty grave, the treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing, nothing.
Better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. heart could tell a story. If my life would sing a song. If I have a testimony. If I have anything at all. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in you alone my joy was found. Children tell their children. Let this be their memory. That all my treasure was in heaven. And you were everything. My joy was found.
I'm gonna tell you a quick story, then why why it's important. This is Jim. Jim is a big fan of Hope for Women Pregnancy Center, but he didn't know how to support them. One day at church, Jim heard about a baby bottle fundraiser. He thought, I can fill a baby bottle with change. So he grabbed a bottle from his church, then went into his wallet. He grabbed a couple coins and a $5 bill. He was off to a great start. Now Jim just needed a few other ways to fill his bottle. He decided he could look through his couch. And he also looked through his car, but it still wasn't enough. So he got some cans. On his way home from dropping off those cans, Jim decided to get a coffee. When the cashier handed him some change, he thought, this is a great way to fill up my baby bottle. Jim made sure to go a few extra times that week.
Like 36 times?
That Sunday, Jim was proud to come to church with a full baby bottle, with $27 of change. Now, here's why the story is important. You see, Jim wasn't the only one doing this. He had a whole community with him. And together, they raised almost $40,000. For this fundraiser to work, we need everyone to chip in, which means we need your help. You can fill a bottle too. You just need to collect cash, checks, or even a credit card number. You can also go on to babybottles.ca and fill up your virtual bottle there. Help support Hope for Women. Fill a bottle, save a life.
It's Mother's Day. So here's a step-by-step guide on how to make all those Proverbs 31 ladies feel great on their special day. Step 1. Locate some beautiful flowers. Moms love saving money, so try to find some free ones. Step 2. Get the flowers and the water as quick as you can. Can't have them dying on ya. Step 3. Find some more beautiful flowers, but this time let the scissors do all the work. Come on. Perfection. Step 4. Find a bow or something to jazz things up a bit. Remember, people, it's all about the details. Step 5. Enlist your baby sister to help you make a thoughtful Mother's Day card.
I knew you couldn't be trusted.
Step 6. If you have another sister waiting in the bullpen, grab her instead. Preferably one that appreciates the delicate art of watercoloring.
You have a gift.
Thank you.
Hey, honey, I'm home. Hey, sweetie.
It's a thought that counts, I guess.
Well, good morning. Hey, it's Mother's Day. And for all you moms out there, wishing you God's very, very best, wishing you that you would be blessed and just absolutely overwhelmed with all the gifts and so forth that you get. And you know, I know Mother's Day isn't easy for everyone. I know there are people that are, there's ladies out there that are either single moms or ladies that never were a mom. I just want to honor you. I want to honor all ladies today. I want you to to know how incredibly important you are to the family of God, how important you are to God Himself, and we absolutely love you. And I want to take some time to focus on Mother's Day, but really what I want to do here this morning is, as we look through the scriptures today, we want to talk not just about moms, but we want to talk about all of us in general and some principles that we're going to look at. But let's take a look at a scripture from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Before we jump into that, though, I just want to ask you, have you ever met a woman or a mom with attitude? You know what I'm talking about. Someone that is got serious attitude. Like a picture of this lady here. Her name is Jacqueline. Jacqueline here is 92 years old and she's still pumping iron. Now, if you knew anything about Jacqueline, it would make sense when you saw this picture, because she actually was Sylvester Stallone's mother. So you can see that. Oh, I love this painting. Love this painting of this lady. I don't know who she is, but you can look in her face and you look at the way she's dressed, and man, there's no question she's got some sort of attitude. Don't be messing with her. I wonder, have you ever met a grandmother who's got attitude? Like this one here. I love it. I love it. Grandma on a bike. I mean, of course, that doesn't happen, does it? It did happen, actually, a number of years ago, and it actually happened here at the church. I just want to show you this very short video. All right, there comes Thelma and Dave on the motorbike.
Oh, I see.
Harley girl! Isn't that great? That was Thelma Stevens. She's gone to be with the Lord, but she so desperately wanted to be on the bike with Dave, and he took her around the church parking lot at the time. Now listen, I don't want to talk about biker moms or biker grandmas or stuff, but I want to talk about attitudes that moms have, and that maybe all of us need to have, that honor God. The scripture we will look at is not so much talking about mothers, but about a caregiver who we can certainly learn from. A caregiver who makes references to moms when he talks about the right type of attitudes that we all need to have when serving the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 6 to 9 says this: "As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you have become so dear to us. Surely you remember, brothers, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you." This morning we're going to deviate a little bit from our regular sermon series. We've been talking through the book of Hebrews, but as we look in this portion of scripture, we want to look at some things from it, how Paul, as a caregiver to the church of Thessalonica, he was able to show us how we can help others on their spiritual journey by having the appropriate attitudes as well. And this is for you moms, but this is for everyone. Let's just open in prayer. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the opportunity to take time to discover how it is applicable to us here today. Lord, as we try to honor moms today, Father, I pray you would speak to them and speak to the ladies that are listening to us. And Father, that all of us would understand our responsibility to have an appropriate attitude when we live out this life, this Christian walk that you have called us to. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, right attitudes. It's got to start, first of all, with an attitude of gentleness. Paul says here, as an apostle of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. Gentleness is seen first and foremost in selflessness. He says, as apostle of Christ, we could have been a burden to you. See, here's the point. Paul was a prestigious man in the church at the time. time. He was an apostle. He was the one that established all these churches, and realistically, he should have been one that was honored. Now, years ago, I was in a church in Kenya, and I was to speak on a Sunday morning, and as I was to be speaking, they actually ushered me in, and the other pastor, the lead pastor, we walked in, and everybody stood up and gave, I guess, to show honor, and I just like, oh, please, don't do this. See, Paul could have demanded that kind of stuff, but he didn't. He didn't demand the church to show him specific honor. He didn't demand them to support him and financially be there for him. He never took advantage of this church. Later on, and we'll look at this in a little bit, later on in verse 9, he says, we work night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preach the gospel of God to you. Again, we'll talk more about that. But the point was, he was making it a part of his life to live selflessly when he was dealing with the people there. Now let me talk to you moms for just a second. Imagine it's 2 a.m. Now you've been there. 2 a.m. and baby starts crying. Now you don't like it. And your hubby, who's snoring beside you, doesn't have the equipment to take care of this. So you pull yourself out from under your toasty duvet and you go and you feed the baby. See, a good mom puts baby first before herself. I think that's an attitude we all need to have. I think actually, and I know actually, that it's biblically that we should have that kind of attitude. Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, he says, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. See, there's so many places that we could be living this out. And there's so many places I see this attitude being broken on a regular basis. People not looking out for others' interests, but for themselves, first of all. Example, if you live anywhere out here in Surrey, if you've driven down Fraser Highway in the last little while, you have noticed the incredible amount of construction that is going on. Actually, to be honest with you, I can sometimes get to work faster on my bicycle than in my car because traffic is brutal. So what happens is that you've got two lanes and they merge into one lane. And you know, the right thing to do is to use the zipper. You know what I'm talking about? You come in and people as a zipper just take turns going in like this, right? But there are some people, oh Lord, there are some people, they just don't understand the reality that letting a person in isn't going to make you any slower, faster. It's actually polite to let someone in. And I see it so many times where a guy is trying to get in and this other person absolutely does not let them in. It's just having the right type of selfless attitude. One example, but it can translate to so many places in our lives. Gentleness means there has to be selflessness. Secondly, there has to be tenderness. Paul says, but we were gentle among you. Now, the word gentle here means to be placid, gentle, mild, easy, and compliant. You know, I remember quite a few years ago, I was at a conference, a district conference, and we had what we call hubs. So there are little different gatherings throughout the conference where you can go and you can get some additional information in the afternoon. And one of the hubs was run by a comedian. And I thought, you know what? The morning session, please don't tell Ken Russell this. The morning session for me was a little boring. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to go to this comedian. Let's just have some fun and laugh a little bit. So I went to the comedian session. I have no idea. I can't remember what it was about. All I remember is I sat down. And when I sat, I'm like, okay, here we go. I'm looking forward to this, right? And I sat down and he comes in. He says, morning. All right, today we're going to be talking about whatever the topic was. Okay, let me just ask you a question. As how many people understand this concept? Now, let me just ask you a question. And he asked us a question, to get some information from us. And somebody answered. And he said, nope, you're wrong. Somebody else, nope, you're wrong. And I'm sitting there, I'm going, what's going on? To be honest with you, it was painful. It was painful because he was not connecting with us. He was not being fun at all. And you just didn't want to be there. It's very different than what Paul is talking about right here. See, what Paul is talking about here is he is talking about being in the actual being right there with the people, having time with the people, associating with them, hearing them out, and just investing in them, doing it in a gentle and a tender way, not overbearing. You know, I remember in Germany, we sometimes would go into these churches and we'd have this pulpit that is set up above everybody else, and the pastor kind of would speak down at people. See, God doesn't want us to speak down at people. God doesn't want us to put ourselves above others. He wants us to be tender and to be, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2, to be completely humble and gentle, be patient with one another in love. This is what a mother is about, isn't it? A good mother is one that is tender with her children, one that is gentle. I can just see that mom gently kissing the child and caressing him and taking care of him and changing him. Sally comes over, she has two kids, and her oldest little guy, his name is Kai, and when he comes over, I gotta tell you, I'm not gentle. I love taking him and throwing him over my shoulder and tickling him, and he's screaming and I'm screaming and we're kind of wrestling back and forth. It's not really what this is talking about here. Tenderness is something that we need to have when it comes to having a right attitude. Gentleness is being selfless, it's being tender, it's being nourishing. Paul said it's like a mother caring for her little children. Paul didn't feed on the people at that time. He fed them. In other words, he didn't try to drag things out of them and somehow use them. No, he invested in them. He cared for the Thessalonian church. He cared about their spiritual needs. He wasn't out there trying to make himself great. This was very, very foreign in that time period, especially in the period of Rome, where the Romans, man, they didn't give a rip about you. They would slam you down. They would do whatever they could to get their way. Nourishing, give it a rest. Their thing was, you better obey me or you're toast. And that kind of mentality was something that was practiced, unfortunately, that kind of overbearing mentality, even in some of the churches. The term caring here primarily means to heat, to soften by heat, then to keep warm, as of birds covering their young with their feathers. Can you see it? Can you see a young mother taking her child into her arms and holding the child close to her, maybe warming her child with her own body so the child is nourished and cared for? One commentary said this, I like this, you cannot be a nursing mother and turn your baby over to someone else. That baby must be in your arms, next to your heart. The nursing mother eats the food and transforms it into milk for the baby. The mature Christian feeds on the Word of God and then shares its nourishment with the younger believers so they will grow. It's a beautiful picture, and I'll talk more about that in a second, but the picture is of tenderly nourishing that child or nourishing the people around us. It takes time and energy to care for kids. And Paul here, he's realized the energy and the time it would take to nourish these new converts. He wasn't about to turn the converts over to a babysitter. He made sacrifices and cared for them himself. He did not tell them just to go out and read a book. No. He helped them to develop in their spiritual walk by being with them. I wonder if we do the same. I wonder if we have an attitude of nourishing people people around us, in our circle of influence? Do we care about them and take time for them? Mom, thank you. Thank you, moms, for nurturing. Thank you for having this attitude of gentleness. Thank you, mom, secondly, for having an attitude of love. Love that is sincere. Verse 8 says, we love you so much, Paul says, because you have become so dear to us. One commentary says this, I love this, when it talks about that first little phrase, we love you so much. This means to long for someone passionately and earnestly, and being linked to a mother's love is intended here to express an affection so deep and compelling as to be unsurpassing. This isn't the kind of love that is faked or can be faked. I'm sure you've met that somebody with those kind of love, that kind of fake love. You know what I'm talking about? Somebody who says, yeah, they love you, but you know that's just a whole bunch of words. It's kind of like this picture where he's consoling his wife, but realistically, he doesn't give a rip about what she's going through, and he's his Facebook on his phone. No, Paul says in Romans chapter 12 verse 9, love must be sincere. We need to hate what is evil. We need to cling to what is good. We need to make sure that when we are loving, that it's not just a bunch of empty words, but it's seen in our kindness. It's seen in our selfless deeds that we do for others. This is the kind of attitude God wants us to have when we are with others. This is the kind of love that God wants moms to have, and that they show that kind of love to their children, that it is a sincere love. Love needs to be something that is absolutely sincere. Secondly, love needs to be giving. He says here, we love you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. See, for Paul, this wasn't just about preaching to these people and then walking away. And that's pretty easy to do. It's like, you know, you see someone that is going through a hard time, and you say, you know what, let me pray for you. And you pray for them and say, have a great day. And we take off and we leave them there without doing anything more. No, see, Paul was willing to go beyond just preaching or just saying some words. No, he was going to put it into action. He was going to invest in them. And he spent a lot of time caring for the people here in Thessalonica. He gave himself to them. See, here's the thing. Nursing mothers, moms, that they give their baby that nourishment that they want, that they need, don't then, after they fed that child, put them in a corner and walk away. They don't do that. You know, I remember years ago, my brother and sister-in-law, they were looking into adopting a child. And my sister-in-law, she traveled to Russia to go to an orphanage to see if they could adopt a child from the orphanage. And as she was there, she said she was appalled at the way these children were treated. She said what would happen was a child would be taken, a bottle would be thrust into its mouth, and then the nurse or whoever the caretaker was would go on to the next child and burp them, put the child back in the crib, and that was the end of it. Or if the child was a little bit bigger, they would take a big spoon and just shovel the food into its mouth quickly and quickly, done, put it back in the crib and walk out and went to the next child. Now, to be fair, there were so many children and only so few caregivers, but I feel for children like that. There's no affection. There's no tenderness. There's no compassion or love that is shown. It is just, it's an assembly line. And this is what God does not want us to do. He doesn't want us just to do our thing and then move on. No, he wants us to be willing to give, to invest. And this is the kind of thing that God expects of us, and God expects of moms, is to invest in the children and to invest the things that are positive. See, the thing about a mom is that, especially a mom that's nursing, is what they eat, they pass on to the child. So can you imagine that you are a mom and you just had your jalapenos for breakfast, because that's what all moms have for breakfast, is a bunch of jalapenos. And you went to nurse little Johnny. Now, I'm pretty sure that Johnny is going to be affected by what you ate. And in the same way, we have to be careful, folks, that what we take in that we give out is not going to be destructive. So see, if we're filling our mind with unhealthy, bad attitudes or destructive media and so forth, and then we are passing, if we spend time with children or with others around, you're going to pass that on. You're going to pass on that destructive poison to those that are around you. Love is giving. It's passing on those things that are appropriate and caring for those around us. I want to just say thank you, moms. Thank you, moms, for having an attitude of love. The third attitude that Paul talks about here in this portion of scripture is an attitude of commitment, of laboring. Now, I'm not talking about the birthing process, though that is called labor, I guess, for a reason. To be honest with you, okay, I mean, it can't all be that bad. I mean, seriously, laboring, giving a birth to a child. Have you ever seen a man cold? Now, that's bad. Okay, I'm gonna get some nasty emails here. Obviously, I'm jesting here. But what Paul says here in verse 9, he says, "Surely you remember, brothers, our toils and hardship." Another version says, "Our labor and toil." What does that mean? What does that word labor mean? It means arduous, wearying toil involving sweat and fatigue, and emphasizes the weariness which follows on the straining of all one's power to the utmost. I think, honestly, that probably describes childbirth in a very, very big way. Beyond that, it's a proper word that was used for physical tiredness because of heavy work or because of heat or over extreme exertion. Paul, he is talking about his absolute strenuous work amongst the people there. He worked hard, very hard, to make sure these guys were taken care of. He spent long hours with them. He helped them in their spiritual journey. And it took work. It took hard, hard work. Can I say, moms, I want to honor you, because sometimes we overlook the hard work that you do. A mom, she is a confidant. She is a cheerleader. She is a housekeeper. She is a guardian. She is a best friend. She is a personal assistant, a therapist, a nurturer, a nurse, a teacher, a driver, a chef. She is a bank. She is a hero, and so much, much, much more. How would you like to have that on your resume? How would you like to have that on your expected job description? These are the things that are needed. See, there is a lot of things that moms do, and an attitude of commitment, regardless of what you do, it takes work. In marriages, in relationships, in businesses, in motherhood, it takes work, and never underestimate it. We need to be committed to labor. We need, secondly, to be committed to generosity. The last part of verse 9 says, "We work night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preach the gospel of God to you." Paul did not want to be a financial burden to the Thessalonians. He made it a point to work hard so that they wouldn't be able to say, "Yeah, Paul, you only come in here because you're trying to pad your pockets and you're trying to get rich off of our coin." No. Paul actually said, "I'm not only not taking from you, I am giving to you to make sure that I could be a blessing to you." There's an old saying that says, "Man's work is from sun to sun, but a woman's work or a mother's work is never done." Hey, mom, can you imagine that you were able to start a mother's union? Now, just imagine it for a second. And you are only going to work for 8 hours. At that time, after 8 hours, you punched the clock and you were gone. I mean, if Junior was out there screaming his head off, "Hey, I'm off the clock. That's up to somebody else. That's up to dad or one of the neighbors." Yeah, right. You probably wouldn't do that. So I'm thinking maybe some of you wish you could, but you probably wouldn't do that. See, Paul is saying here that he wasn't a paid nurse who worked by the hour. He wasn't a hired babysitter. He did not belong to a union. He worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while he preached the gospel of God to them. commitment is being generous with your time. It's being generous with your love. It's being generous with your investment in others. I've said this before, but I got to tell you, one of the things that I regret so much as being a dad was when Lucas was born, that first year, I was so involved in so many things. I had three jobs at the time trying to make ends meet. I spent precious little time with him. And you know what? I got to tell you, to this day, it absolutely kills me that I wasn't able to spend more time with him. I didn't invest where the most important place was to invest, and that was in my family. Hey, let me ask you, are you investing? Are you giving generously in the right places? Are you investing? Are you mentoring? Are you sharing your life with others around you? Commitment requires generosity. And we are looking for moms. We are looking for ladies. We are looking for people that are generous in their attitude towards others. Hey, listen, we need people with attitude. We need moms with attitude. We need people in the family of God that have the proper attitude. Attitude of gentleness, of love, and of contentment. Paul says something here that I want to end with in verse 9. He starts verse 9 by saying this, surely you remember. Surely you remember. We want to remember. We want to remember those that have invested in our lives. We want to remember those that were our mentors, our family members, those who put themselves out there to love us. We want to remember our moms, but I also encourage you to invest in others that you could be remembered for the right things. We want to honor you today. We want to honor you today, moms especially, but we want to encourage every one of you today to have the appropriate attitudes that honor God above all else so that you can be a blessing to people in your circle of influence. Father, I thank you for Mother's Day. Thank you for moms. Thank you for ladies that are part of our community. God, we just want to honor them. We just want to say how much we appreciate the fact that you have given us these wonderful women who have invested in our lives, who have shown us your love, who have been involved in areas that maybe others aren't involved in. God, would you bless? Would you empower? Would you encourage? Would you anoint? Would you strengthen? Would you heal where healing is needed? Father God, would you just be so near our moms, our ladies, Father God. Bless them, especially at this day. And I pray that as children, I pray as workers together in the church, Father, that we would honor our ladies and especially our moms. God, we thank you. We give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, thank you again for joining me here this morning. I don't know where you're at today, where things are at with you, but I just want to say God loves you. You're so incredibly important to him. He wants to help you to have the right attitude. My prayer is that you would do whatever you can to honor God so that you can be a blessing to others. And moms, once again, I love you. God loves you. I wish I could give you just a big hug, but know that God is with you and he will give you a blessed day. God bless you. We will see you next week.